in place of Emmanuel, which is the director of this department. Unfortunately, he's very busy with exams and other administrative duties, but he's very wonderful to say important to the country. So, nothing to say anymore. So, I mean, Francesco will introduce the manifestation.
So I must be very short, otherwise Mario will beat me.
Yes.
The idea of Lady Civic election is more or less known to everybody. I will simply say that I was obliged, and it was at the end a pleasure, to read the book by Tudor Ratio when I was a student of theoretical physics, and it was a very interesting experience. Painful, but but I must tell that Arnold is worse. So in a given moment, the book of Tudor was a relaxing reading compared with Arnold's book. So when I met him in Perpignan, and also David Stegman and Pierre Sepechère, previous residents of the prize, heard his talk, we decided to propose to the other members his candidature. He is the typical representative of the man in mathematics and mechanics and physics. So I think that his originality is not disputable. So I believe he really deserves the prize. I invited a young researcher from Germany, and the other committee members agreed about this invitation. Simon Oexter, he will talk about variational principles also from an historical point of view. And finally, after the break, Professor Mauro Caffara will present these results. I must only tell about him that he was very nice, supporting with his high competence the International Journal of Memos, which had an editorial board lacking experts in relativity. And he was so kind to support us in several equations, some of them embarrassing. So I thank him for this, but we'll talk about his contribution in the next part. So we have the presentation by Tudor Ratio, followed by the one of Simon Oexter after, then coffee break, and then the presentation of Professor Kafka. So please,
thank you.
We will repeat the record.
Thank you very much. Let me wake the machine up. Okay, it's a great honor for me to be even connected with the name of Levi Civita, one of my heroes. As a geometer, especially as an applied geometer, Levi Civita is one of the people who showed the way. Modern geometry applied to mechanics, physics, everything. I would like to talk to you about some fluids. I stumbled across them myself. I'm not an expert. But there is so much to be done here that I think you will enjoy it. Also, I followed the advice of Francesco. I tried to put in something for everyone here. It's going to be, of course, heavily geometrical. I have the best intentions, Mario, to do some analysis. I'm not sure if I get there. But I try. So this is what I would like to do. Probably I won't be able to do everything. I want to tell you about two models of liquid crystal dynamics. In fact, there are three. Then I will tell you something about the theorem of Poincaré, how to generalize it, And then I come back with quite powerful tools to understand the equations that I show you here, which look quite complicated. In fact, they are not. And then I will tell you, at least I will at least state something, how it's the solution of an open problem that was done with my co-authors here. François Guebalmin is my former student at the Laboratoire de Meteorologie Dynamique at the CNRS in Paris, and Cesare Tronci, who's from Lecce, was my postdoc, and is now at Surrey. So Cesare was joined us for the solution of the problem after we understood the geometry. Okay, so first of all, everything is conservative. I know that in liquid crystals dissipation is important. I'm just trying to understand the geometry. That's all I'm trying to do. And then I will add the other terms. And when I do an analysis, of course, I'm going to need them because I need regularizing effects of the Laplacian. So that's what I'm telling you. It's by no means finished what I'm doing here. Okay. So what are liquid crystals? Now, if you are like me, you probably know nothing about it, except that this screen is liquid crystal. That's basically all I knew when I started. There is a tutorial which is absolutely excellent. It's coming from here. It's the University of Kent. The University of Kent turns out to be the world center of experiments in this. I didn't know. These guys are just experimentalists. So a liquid crystal is a state that is between crystal and isotropic liquid. It behaves like a liquid sometimes, it behaves like a solid sometimes, and you're going to see. So what's the history of it? I'm going to tell you the history. So the first guy who came across is this guy, Friedrich Reinitzer. He's a botanist and chemist, and in 1888 he accidentally discovered the strange behavior of this thing called cholesteryl benzoate. And this is what is called today liquid crystal. Of course, he couldn't understand it, so he was going around trying to talk to people, and sure enough, a physicist took immediately, so it's interesting, it's Otto Lehmann, and he's really the father of liquid crystal theory. For this, he was proposed 10 times for the Nobel Prize, never got it. Eventually, he died, so he wasn't proposed anymore. The last 10 years of his life, every year he was proposed for the Nobel Prize. He didn't get it. I think he should have. The next one is Georges Friedel, who's a mineralogist, who made a classification which is still due today with some modifications. And the real work, the real serious work, comes with Carlo Sen. He's a theoretical physicist. And it's a tongue-in-cheek what he says, it's elasticity theory of liquid crystals, right? He wants to emphasize they're solids and liquids at the same time, right? Now, since the mid-60s, the entire theoretical and experimental development is due to Pierre-Gilles de Gennes, who did get the Nobel Prize for it. The problem is that de Gennes hated mathematics. He was actively campaigning on public French TV against mathematics, saying it's useless. And you can see that, because if you look at de Gennes' book, if you read it as a, you take the information, and me as a mathematician, just what are the phenomena, the explanation as a physicist, it's wonderful. The moment he starts the mathematics, you want to pull your hair out. He has no idea what he's writing. I mean, he writes elliptic equations without boundaries and boundary conditions, anyway. But he did indeed a lot. So now, the interesting thing is that people need a rigorous formulation. And to the shame of mathematicians and physicists, it was neither of them who insisted on rigor. It was engineers who insisted. It's quite an astounding statement. So these are all engineers. Erikson, Leslie, L'Huillier, Ray Erringen. These are the key people in the modern theory. Erikson was in the math department, but just about. I mean, he's not really, really considered a mathematician. He's a very theoretical engineer. The other ones are straight out engineers. For example, Alejandro Rey at Montreal. Just look at his papers. I mean, the guy is struggling with mathematics. He's writing bifurcation diagrams. Anybody who does dynamics recognizes it. There's a lot to be done. And he knows it, but he doesn't have the tools. I spent hours with him talking. Very, very interesting guy. Eringen died. So the only ones who are alive are these guys. I'm going to show them. There are various phases. Pneumatic, smectic, cholesteric, whatever. And the names are coming all from Greek, of course. Okay. So, why doesn't it work? Why doesn't it work? Okay. Ah, let me show you pictures now, so that you see what's going on. So, these are the three phases. Pneumatic, they're sort of, there are three kinds of things that you can see. Things that sort of point roughly in the same direction, things that sort of point in each floor of the building in the same direction, and things that are completely turning around, and those are the cholesteric ones. The theory is only for pneumatic so far, and the dynamic theory. So here, for example, is a solid. You see, these are crystals. This is smectic. This is pneumatic, this is liquid, right? Here everything is ordered. Here, you know, the floors in the building are still there, but it's total disorder here. No more floors, but they're still pointing something. And here is total chaos with the particles. Every particle does what it wants. Okay, so more pictures. Here is something, there's in DNA. This is a movie, in fact. This is a crystal who's taking over a liquid crystal. So this guy is growing, growing, growing. When everything is done, all that's left is here. These are all coming from Kent State. You just pick them up from the web. And there is more of these. Of course, there is the whole theory of the singularities is not solved. This is very important. I have some ideas, but I don't know what to do. There is more here. Here, for example, are smectic ones. If they point straight out, you see this. If they are tilted, it gets worse. And if they're more tilted, it gets all wishy-washy like this. These are cholesteric ones. I mean, this is a beautiful picture. And they appear in nature. Here is a bug with liquid crystal on it. Okay, here are the dramatis personae, right? So here is Mr. Erickson, interviewed in 2013 by John Ball via Skype. There was a program in complex fluids at the Newton Institute. So we had he gave an interview. It was very, very interesting. So he's one of the fathers of all this theory who's still alive. The other ones are not. Here he is with Leslie. And Leslie, I don't know if you know, he was quite a colorful figure. He was a rabid Scottish nationalist. He was an elder in the church of in Scotskirk, and he wanted independence of Scotland when it was not fashionable. But, you know, he died a while ago. Here is Ahmad Cemal Eringen, who is an engineer, a civil engineer at Princeton, who has written a lot. I'm going to tell you about Eringen. I have a lot of admiration towards him. In fact, we finished our paper with Gebalma, and we looked for him, because we wanted to send him the paper. And by the time we found him, we found out that he died a few months before. He was very old. He was living in Colorado with his daughter. Okay. So here is what's going on. There are more theories. There are three of them. Director theory due to Osen, Frank, Zöcher, Erickson, and Leslie. There is a micropolar and microstress theory and other micro ones due to Eringen. I'm going to talk a lot about these two. Then there is the ordered micropolar approach due to Lillier and Ray, which combines the director theory with micropolar models. It's a very nice model. There is no way I can present you also this. Okay, I'm going to talk only about pneumatics. And the certain constant has to set to do equal. So n dot curl n doesn't appear. I'm going to come to that. So I'm talking about a bounded domain in R3, but you will see immediately that it doesn't matter. It can be a Riemannian manifold. all boundary conditions are ignored, all integration by parts are allowed, there are no boundary terms, they will vanish, you know, it's all formal. And you see how far I get. So let me show you the equations. Right? I'm copying equations at this point. So the key assumption in Erikson-Lesty theory is the following. In fluids, you have particles, and there is total democracy between particles. Right? You can mix them. You have the diffeomorphism group that mixes them. You know, you don't care. Now you do. So in the first approximation, what they do is every particle carries a little stick. I shouldn't say arrow because it's really in projective space, but I will not do that. I will simplify the problem. I think of the sphere with antipodal points identified. But strictly speaking, you really should work on projective space. And there is a paper of Gebarma and Tronchi who actually do that. It doesn't really add much. But then it's literally what they are saying. And this is given by this director, N. N and minus N are assumed to be equivalent, right? I'm in projective space. So here is what they write. Let's look at these equations a little bit. This we recognize. This is the material derivative, right? If I'm a geometer, I think nabla index U, covariant. And if I'm, you know, a mechanician in R3, I think U dot grad, right? And so this we understand perfectly well. Right? And this I also understand is the gradient of something. Okay, the sign is wrong, but who cares? Right? I just changed the function. So up to here, I recognize compressible Euler. And there is something else, which I should expect. So this has to do with the director. So this comma J means take derivative relative to that. Here is mass conservation. So I understand perfectly well this piece, and this piece is just fluid, right? And something else is going on. Okay, so there is an expression which is called molecular field, which appears so often that it has a name. So there it is. And there is another equation in which you have the second covariant derivative. J is a constant. Right, out of the three moments of inertia, only one is left. That's the one. So the terminology is exactly as you would expect. Eulerian velocity, Eulerian mass density, this is the director, and this is called the micro-inertia constant, the J, and this F is the free energy. So who is this free energy? This is the physics comes in. This is due to Osen, Zöcher, Frank, and Frank, and this is how it looks like. These are the terms. Rho F, I put rho minus 1 by tradition. It turns out that if you think of it as a function of 1 over rho, the expressions look better ultimately. So I just stick with the terminology and notation that is traditional. But this is it's not serious. It's pure cosmetics, right? So here they are. This is called splay, this is called twist, this is called bend. So splay is, in English, you do that, right? And this is the picture. This is bending, we all understand, and twisting, we also understand. Just twist it. Okay, so the question is, these are conservative equations. I erased all the terms that have dissipation. What is the variational / Hamiltonian structure of these equations? We know about the Hamiltonian, we did everything. I will not tell you about the Hamiltonian structure, it's more complicated. It will take me longer time. I will talk purely variational here. It's also more in spirit with the Vicivita, right? So, what does Eringen do? Eringen says, well, wait a moment, this is not quite correct. This is too much. Too much of a simplification. So, he replaces point particles by little blobs, very small blobs. But the blobs are not solid, they're like jello. They can move, they can squish, but they retain their individuality, right? So, then he deals with two motions. He calls these microfluids. They're liquid crystals. But there are others. Here they are, and many, many other ones. And Eringen has written many, many papers, including some books when he was almost 90, which are remarkable. I will come to that. So what does he say? I have a material particle P in a microfluid, and it's characterized by its position, by its material position X. So I go by the standard notation. Material points are capital letters, little letters are Eulerian points and Eulerian quantities. And by some vector, capital Xi, vector tensor something, we will come to that, attached to P, that denotes the orientation and intrinsic deformation of P, for example. Both of them have their own motion. Well, the first one is, well, the material point goes to the spatial point. Okay, like we do in fluids. That we understand. And of course, this guy also moves, but this guy also now is going to depend on everything, also on x. So there is a macro motion and a micro motion. Right? There is an overall fluid, and there is something else happening within the fluid. The second key assumption that he does, he says, well, that's very nice, but I just told you that my bubbles are extremely small, even though they are not particles. So I can live happily with linear approximation. Linear approximation in the quantity having to do with the micro motion. Of course, I cannot do anything about x and t, but this now is some matrix, if you want, if I'm in R3, acting on c. So this better be some invertible matrix, and at least orientation should be preserved. Okay, but it's not necessary, of course. What? Why is it going backwards? Okay. So you can, if you have this group, then it's called micromorphic. If you have this group, well, let me start at the end. It's easier. If you have SO3, AA transpose is the identity. It's called micropolar. And if you have like a conformal version of that, then it's called microstretch. But there are other groups. I can put, for example, the symplectic group. Why not? Some other group that depends on the material. This is modeling now. I don't care. So for me, I have a group which I call O, which is the order parameter group, that the way they call them. And for example, O is SO3, if I do micropolar. For example, I don't need to. I will simplify. So here comes Erringer. So you want to go, as a mathematician, you want to go to a physicist or engineer, and the first thing you ask is, please give me the equations of motion. Right? I'm a mathematician, I'm not modeling. I trust you. You are God. Just give me the equations. This is a very loaded question. It's not so easy to get the simple answer. And those of you who have done interdisciplinary know very well the problem. So you go to Erringer's book. There are two volumes, one solid, one fluid. We understand the fluid, and we're in the process of writing the solid. So you look there. Well, here is the notation. Of course, this is the material derivative or covariant derivative. And you see this equation. Well, this is good, right? It's exactly what you would expect. Some gradient here. I'm copying them. This is exactly what he wrote. Of something, it's fine. I recognize this. I immediately recognize this, conservation of mass. Then you are in trouble. You can't find anything for a while. And he keeps insisting that this is an equation of motion. So, you know, at a certain point you break down. You know, okay, if he says it's an equation of motion, this is an equation of motion. Well, 30 pages later you discover, in fact, that it is. Because this sigma is, in fact, this. So actually there is a ddt there. Right? So if you replace your sigma with this, you actually get equations of motion. I'm going to show you something. So when did we decide that this is an interesting problem? This term and this equation. Only if you recognize this. Mu is an angular velocity of the micro motion. This is the moment of inertia. This is the angular momentum. He's trying to do rigid body motion. There is no rigid body because it's wobbling, right? It's squishing. But something like that better be true. And if you look at this equation here, this equation I knew. When I saw this equation, I knew exactly what he's talking about. And I'm going to write it in a humane way, not like this. So this equation is the equation that you would get if you would write the equations of the rigid body motion from the point of view of an observer looking at the body. When we write Euler's equations, we write them in convective or body representation. But I have the right to write the equations, me looking at it, right? Now I'm Eulerian. So what are the Eulerian equations of motion for the rigid body? Clearly, the moment of inertia is moving, right? It cannot be always diagonalized because it's moving. What are the equations? These ones. Literally, these ones written in components. At that point, I knew something very serious is going on because there must be deep group theory going on. Good. Now comes this equation. Erringer never wrote it down. So just counting variables, you have a problem. you're missing equations. You don't have the gamma is there. You know, you have to have an equation for it. Right? But Ariel keeps telling you that I have solved this equation. I can write the solution down if I know the particle path, etc. So what he's trying to tell me is that he has something like an advection, like mass conservation. Right? You don't need to write mass conservation. You can simply say that mass is not exchanged between flow lines, which is this equation, right? This is what Erdinger sort of tells you, but he puts condition, he puts initial conditions on top. So this equation is what Erdinger should have written had he written down exactly what he spoke. Now we have at least a system in which we have as many equations as unknowns. There are problems here with indices, I should tell you, because sometimes Erdinger considers gamma, so gamma is what? It's a one form, ultimately, with values in the Lie algebra SO3. But SO3 is R3. So sometimes this guy has two indices up and one index down. Sometimes he has one index up and one index down. So you have to be very careful what he does. Because he uses sometimes the isomorphism between SO3 and R3 with the cross product, and sometimes he doesn't, depending on what is convenient for him. Okay, fine. So here is gamma, and this is what it does. And this hat map is exactly this isomorphism. So when I write gamma hat, I take a vector and I put a hat and I get a matrix. And you have to produce this matrix. And psi is the free energy and it depends on rho, written as 1 over rho, j and gamma. And it's defined on this real number. These are symmetric 3x3 matrices and this is some matrix. Okay, a priori. Question, what is the variational structure? What is the relation between them? Clearly, Erdinger should be more general than Erikson-Leslie. Under what conditions does Erdinger recover Erikson-Leslie? No, Erdinger is no fool. So he claimed that, of course, it's true. And he wrote several papers. And he says that you recover Erikson-Leslie if you put the rod-like assumption. That is not a particle, it's a little point. The whole rigid body has collapsed to a point. And all it remains is it's one little piece of a line, which is the moment of inertia, okay? And he says you have to do this. Gamma must be grad n cross n. This is false. This is false. He made a mistake. How Erdinger could do a stupid algebra mistake, I have no idea. Because he did much more complicated computations, and he did them correctly. This is literally false. You can check if you do what he says and spend 2 days, and we did, just to make sure, and you do the computation from A to Z correctly, you will not get this. Of course, we didn't do it this way. We knew it for other reasons that it's false. And then we checked. So, this has created a battle that has raged for 25 years. So here is an example. This guy, well, this is no good, you know, this guy Erdinger doesn't know what he's doing. You have to, and then they come with all sorts of arguments that are physical. We have to change the internal energy, all sorts of things. Erdinger, of course, doesn't let himself be beaten, answers, and it goes on and on and on between the followers of one and this other group. Okay, the story is, I mean, they argue all sorts of things. We solve the problem. This is the problem that we solved with Cesare Tronchi. In fact, Erdinger is right. His model is more general, but not his formulas. And we established the correct relation. And in fact, they're both partially right. Both camps were partially right. They both pointed out things that were correct. Okay. Let me stop. Now I have to do mathematics. I go completely off, right? I will come back in seven, eight slides, I'm back. Poincaré in 1901 writes a paper in which he says, it's a funny paper, it's 1.5 pages long, and the best explanation of this paper is the 37 pages of Marle. But you know, it's Poincaré, of course. I'm not surprised. But this came later, because he wanted to really understand everything. So Poincaré basically says he has no motivation, never worked on this again, never worked on it before, gives no citations. He simply says, this is so interesting that I have to write it down. There are new equations of motion in mechanics, and this is exciting. I'm going to write this down, 1.5 pages. Okay? I'm going to give you a stripped down version of what he says. He does actually much more than what I'm saying. No, it's Poincaré. So let's assume that my configuration space is a Lie group. Poincaré goes even in manifolds and actions, but that's for later. Assume it's a Lie group. So I have a Lagrangian. No problem. Instead of QQ dots, I have G and G dots, right? They just happen to be group elements. I can, and I assume that I have invariants of this Lagrangian, right or left. In this group, I don't have to explain, and I don't have to insist that this is important. There are relative sign changes. One is convective, one is spatial. Okay, so what do I do? I'm looking at a curve, and I take the derivative, G dot. This is a tangent space at G of t, it's a tangent vector G of t. Let me bring it back to the identity, right or left. I mean the Lie algebra. Now I have a Lie algebra curve, either by right or by left, right? So now Poincaré, among other things, is telling you the following thing. The following four things are equivalent. G of t satisfies the Euler Lagrange equations. The variational principle of Hamilton holds for variations with fixed endpoints. That is not news. That is classical mechanics. Who cares? Do I have a group? This is two in general, right? So one is equivalent to two by classical mechanics. Nothing new. Now comes Poincaré. There is an analog of this, and there is an analog of this. So G of t satisfies, instead of this, that what we call today the Euler-Poincaré equations hold, which is d dt del L del xi, plus or minus, plus for left, minus for right, del L del xi, add star xi. So I have to tell you what this means. If I take a Lie algebra element xi, I can take a bracket with it. It's a linear operation. Add xi of eta is the bracket of xi with eta. This is a linear map for every xi fixed. Take the dual that goes from G star to G star. That's what I'm doing. I transpose the matrix, if you wish. Okay? Del L del xi is the Fréchet derivative abstractly, or the functional derivative in infinite dimensions. So I use deliberately physicist notation. So del L del xi, if L is in infinite dimension, is the one that with the plus and the minus, you keep integrating by parts, right? It's exactly what you think it is. No mystery. And the Euler-Poincaré variational principle holds delta of L of xi of t dt equal to zero for variations delta xi equal to eta dot plus or minus, here is the relative sign change, xi eta, where eta is an arbitrary path in G that vanishes at the endpoints. Not xi, eta. Okay, that's quite different. Now, let's see what is the content of this theorem. This is classical mechanics, we all know it. Let's prove in our head, it's that simple, that this and this are equivalent. Let's do the computation. If I do delta of that, what do I get? I get delta del xi delta xi. I take my delta xi from here and plug it in. Then I integrate by parts, and I get a d dt of d dt delta xi. Then this is xi eta, it's add xi. I want to isolate eta, I put add star xi, I pull it back. So what am I going to get? I'm going to get this minus this, parenthesis eta. All was true for all the eta vanishing at endpoints, fundamental lemma of calculus of variations, therefore the other guy is zero. Right? Trivial. Okay. That is easy. How about this? Well, G is invariant, let's say on the left. Then I can multiply here with G minus 1, and here I multiply with G minus 1. But G minus 1, G is E. I'm not an idiot to keep writing E. It's a constant. So I have G minus 1 GT. Ah, that's Xi. So, this, I mean, it's not the variational principle that seems to be equal. It's not even the integral. It's the integrand who are equal. These are extremely equal. I don't know how to say, right? They cannot be more equal than that. So what is the content? It's here. This is not a standard variational problem. It's a constrained variational problem. Now, let me explain to you where this comes from. Here's what I do. I have curves. I start here, I go here. I want to find the curve, the solution of the Euler-Lagrange equations. Okay? How do I do it? I take all the paths that start here and end here, and I perturb them. So I have a family of paths, g index epsilon of t, right? What do we do in mathematics? When you run out of any ideas, you take a derivative, right? So I take the dd epsilon of that, right? But if I take the dd epsilon, I get a tangent vector. But if I have a tangent vector, why not bring it back to the identity? Right? So I get something in the Lie algebra. Question, do I get everything or not? No. All I get is this. Not all delta x's are allowed. This you have to prove. Now, if you are a real geometer, you recognize this. Delta is dd epsilon, and dot is ddt. C has to do with ddt. This is dd epsilon ddt, this is ddt d epsilon. They commute on the manifold, but when I do this, they don't commute. The Gauss lemma, they remain in geometry. This is really what I'm doing. So this is not an obvious thing to do. This is much easier than the Gauss lemma abstract on a Riemannian manifold. But this is the Gauss lemma in this case, without metrics, just connections. Okay? Fine. So this is what he does. Now, it's extremely interesting. Look, when I do Hamiltonian mechanics, I'm doing geometry. When I do variational calculus, I do analysis. So now I literally replaced geometry by analysis. This is important because that means that information from here goes here and information from here goes here. I know how to handle this. So as soon as we saw this, but not for this in general, so, oh, this is fantastic. Calculus of variation is a very well developed subject. There is a wall of books from here to there on calculus of variations in the library. Let's go, pick up the book, open the theorem, and we call theorems. I have 100 theorems with no effort. Not one single theorem, not one, about these constrained variational principles. And in an enormous amount of equations of mathematical physics are like this. It's absolutely astounding. Right? They are doing classical. This is not a standard one. It's a constrained one. Not one. Now the question, of course, is, well, if I solve this, have I solved my original problem? The answer is yes. Modulo quadratures. And here it goes. Here is the algorithm. What do you do? First, you restrict to the identity. Of course, it's left invariant, you don't care. You solve the Euler Poincaré equations, so if it's an integrable system, you solve it, like the rigid body. If it's not, you have variational integrators, you do it numerically. And now comes discrete mathematics in it, which is extremely interesting. So that is, nobody's scared by this anymore. Variational integrators, you solve it. Now, you are finished. You solve the linear equation with time-dependent coefficients. Here it is, I put it on the left. Okay? So if you are a physicist, you say this is time ordered exponential means nothing. It means that you have to solve it, it's quadratures. And now is a formula. If I give you a G0, and the solution of the Euler-Lagrange equation is G0, G of T, X of T. X of T from here, G of T from here, finished. I have the solution, I have solved the problem. This is the miracle of reduction. My work has gone down to half the variables, and in flat space. Right, I'm on a Lie algebra, not on a group, which is curvy. It's absolutely amazing. Now, Euler-Poincaré reduction is everywhere, absolutely everywhere. The paper that I wrote with Gebhard Alma in 2009 has 100 pages, of which 30 is theory and 70 is example. And I could go on. When we reached 100 pages, we stopped. Just because we said it's time to stop. That's how many equations are there that are all like this. Now, of course, the problem is that I need more, right? This is just for the free rigid body. So I have to tell you something about the generalization of this, and I needed to tell you a little bit about this. I'm sorry, there is abstract mathematics now. So the idea is very simple. What I described to you works for fluids. Homogeneous, incompressible. Right? Only Euler, which is no physics, it's just geodesic motion. Arnold, I'm talking, Arnold, Eben, Marsden. Right, this is what I'm talking about. But if I do compressible, and this is compressible everywhere, right? For mass equation, I have advect quantities, right? Heavy top is like this. Heavy top is an advected quantity. Is the unit vector on the OZ axis that I see when I sit on the body, I move together with the body, it has an equation. It's gamma dot equal to gamma cross omega. It's an advection equation. The equation that I showed you for J before in Erringen, it's an advection equation. Right? So I need to deal with this. But I need more. So I'm going to go relatively fast over this. It's abstract. I want you to understand just the idea. So I have a representation space that contains all sorts of things. Mass, entropy, magnetic field, director, all sorts of things. And this, any representation induces various representations on the dual, on the Lie algebra, and on the dual of the Lie algebra. Because I'm going to do physics, because I'm going to do fluids, I'm going to work only on the right, because I want to be in Eulerian representation. So I write the action of G on V is V, G acts on V, but I write G on the right. Everything is on the right, the actions. Then I have natural duality pairings between the duals in G or in V. In finite dimensions, these are the duality pairings. In infinite dimensions, you have to choose. These are weak pairings, and this creates problems. This is where analysis ultimately comes in. And now I have a novelty. I'm going to have also what is called affine representations. So these are not representations. You write, for example, I want to have an action on the right. G acts on A by acting in the natural way on the dual, and I add something that doesn't depend on A, depends only on C. In order for this to be an action, an identity has to hold, right? This identity is this identity. Now, you won't recognize it, but this is a famous identity. Any algebraist would immediately jump. You are doing group cohomology. This is extremely interesting, because it means that all this theory is related to a whole other field of mathematics, which is not so easy. It's group cohomology. It's not the Ram cohomology, it's group cohomology. Okay. So, this implies that this is zero. How do you compute the derivative? So, my notation is this way because I want to make my notation easy here. So, this dxc is the derivative, the tangent map of c at the point e in the direction xc, and I just call it d, the derivative of the cocycle. And of course, if you take the derivative of this, you are going to get ultimately two cocycles are intimately related to central extensions. I mean, there's a whole algebra coming in here which I don't actually know how it fits. But something is going on, which is much more than I'm telling you. Okay, and now you compute. You have to compute the transpose, or the dual. So I compute it. There is a very interesting operation, which we call diamond. I'll tell you what it is in a second. That goes from V cross V star and ends up in G. I give you a vector and the covector. Now, this is supposed to be in G star. So I have to feed him a vector in G. And I have to get a real number. I tell you what that real number is. It's the action of xi on the dual of the Lie algebra. There is a sign that I have to take care of, acting on V, duality pairing. Now, this looks like it's not. For a symplectic geometer, there could be nothing more natural than this. This is the momentum map of point transformations in physics. That's exactly what it is. This is the neuter conserved quantity. This is literally what it is. If you're an algebraist or a representation theorist, this you know for other reasons. If you're a symplectic geometer, somebody who does mechanics, you know. You let G act on V, therefore, automatically on the cotangent bundle, and there is a momentum map. The cotangent bundle is V cross V star, and you write the momentum map down. That's what it is. This is diamond. Okay. And then you have to compute all sorts of things. What are the pairings, etc. So you compute. Now I have to tell you what I'm going to do next. I'm going to use the semi-direct product. Think of the Euclidean group. That's what I'm talking about. Now, there are 16 ways of defining semi-direct products, which are all isomorphic, and it depends on the author. So I tell you what are my So you can't open a book and take a formula. You unfortunately have to work everything from by yourself, right? So these are my conventions. This is the definition that is the one that is useful. So here is the Lie group. Here is the Lie algebra. So in the Lie algebra, it's nicer. So the first component is just the bracket of the what it was, and here is xi2 acting on v1 minus xi1 acting on v2. What could be more natural? Right? This is the semi-direct product. At the group level, it's more. Anyway, you have seen in the equation that I have done for Euler-Poincaré that it's not the Lie algebra that matters, it's the dual of the Lie algebra that matters. It was known to Lie in the 1880s. Lie knew that this is more important than the Lie algebra, in spite of what algebraists tell you today. Just look at Lie. Just look at his book. He says it explicitly. So I have to compute this ad star. That's why I compute. I want to point out to you, there is a complication here. Okay, this is what used to be, and it was over. But now I have another term. So I do something. This is this diamond. But here, look what's happening. It's given by the action. This is advection. So the motion of this guy will be action, comes from the group action. Okay, so what happens in a physical problem? In a physical problem, I have a Lagrangian on Tg, and that depends on that parameter. Initial mass distribution, initial entropy distribution, initial magnetic field if it's MHD, the director field at zero, etc., etc., depending on what models you have. Heavy talk, the direction of gravity. Right? So I'm telling you that this L has to be right invariant, and this action again looks completely crazy where it came from. It's not, because this is what is left over when I take the tangent bundle of G cross V star and I take the action of the semi-direct product on itself and I lift it. It turns out that I can erase the third component. It's not obvious. So it's very natural what's happening. And it's in all these problems, this is true. So to be concrete, if I were to freeze the parameter, then I would get, this is what we see in physics, in mechanics. I have Tg. It depends on this, right? I give you the initial mass distribution. Okay, in Lagrangian representation, I have my Lagrangian for the fluid. That's what I'm talking about. Okay, so this is right invariant under a certain symmetry group. I put here C to remind you that it has to do with the co-cycle because it's affine. In other words, if A0 were to be zero, this group is not the whole group. If it would be a representation, it would be the whole group. But if I have a co-cycle, it is not. And right invariance means that there is a relationship between capital L and little l, which is this. Notice, please, that here it's only Vg that is the variable. A0 is frozen. Here it's not, because G is moving. This is what we see in fluids. Lagrangian is velocity, and rho0 is given to you. It's over. Space, rho is moving, right? And then I do exactly like Poincaré did. Well, I'm going to work on the right now. I take g dot, and then I'm taking the curve that goes with the initial condition A0 that goes with this gt. Okay, well, so this is the unique solution of the following affine differential equation with time-dependent coefficients. This is a linear equation with time-dependent coefficients, right? It's quadratures again. And I know what the solution is, quote unquote. This solves this. But of course, I cannot say that because I don't know who g of t is, right? But we have done this in fluids, right? Mass is dragged along the flow. We know that. So then the following are equivalent. So this is the version of Poincaré this way. Exactly as you would expect, Hamilton's variation principle holds for variation delta g of t vanishing at the endpoints. G of t satisfies Euler Lagrange equation for L A0. The constraint variational principle holds for L of xi of t, t of t. Notice A0 is fixed here. And here I have g dot, here I have only xi, but I have A of t. It's quite subtle. Upon using variations of the form, well, I'm right, so there is a minus here. This you have seen before, and there is a variation that goes with this. You just have to compute it, so I computed it. is constrained, and the affine Euler-Poincaré equations hold for this. So here, this is what you saw, this piece. This is Poincaré. If you have advected quantities, you add this. And if you have co-cycled, in other words, internal structure for the material, you also have to add this. It's very clear. So for example, for the rigid body, for compressible flow, you don't have this. There is no internal structure. You have this and this. So what are the equations of motion? This are this and the ones from before. This. This is your system. This is what you need to solve. And of course, there is a reconstruction, etc. Now, when you do complex fluids, what do you do? You have to come to grips with another Lie group that shows up somewhere at the new kind of advection equation, which is this gamma. This equation is funny. It's really funny. It's not like mass conservation or entropy conservation. So here's what you do. If you have a fluid, the configuration space is the diffeomorphism group. Well, in an ideal world where there are no shocks, etc. But let's forget about this. Diffeomorphism group. But I have internal structure. This is given by the order parameter. So I take the functions of whatever class from the domain or the manifold with values in the group of some smoothness class. And I form the semi-direct product. I will show you everything, how you multiply everything. Now, the usual advection equation, exactly as I said, mass density, etc., need to be augmented by a new advected quantity, which comes from an affine representation, which you haven't seen before. Okay. So, let's get going. Let's work. So, here is the action that defines the semi-direct product, and this is the multiplication. So, this is composition of diffeomorphisms. This is composition of diffeomorphisms, changing variables, and then you multiply in the group. This guy, you multiply him with this pointwise. What is the Lie algebra? Well, it's the Lie algebra of this. It's the semi-direct product of this with functions. Here is the bracket, and all these operations are taken pointwise. For example, d nu dot nu of x, the v of x is d nu of x applied to v of x, etc. It's the only way that the symbols make sense. Okay, and then I have to look at the dual of the Lie algebra. So the dual of the Lie algebra is functions and forms, because they are vector fields, and functions with values in the dual of the Lie algebra. And my pairing is L2 pairing. What else can I take, right? And then I compute the coadjoint action, and I get a formula. This is the Lie derivative, this is the divergence, this is a pointwise operation, this is the pointwise add star action, this is the divergence. Okay, and you can make sense out of every single symbol. They're pointwise, you compute them pointwise. Okay, I'm not going to go into this. And formulas that you know and love are true. Okay, if I do Erickson-Leslie, what do I do? If I do Erickson-Leslie, I don't have enough structure. I don't have affine. Look what's happening. I take my group. I have a macromotion and a micromotion. My advected variables are functions, and functions with values in R3. This corresponds to rho, sort of as a density because I fix a volume, and n, the director field. Values in R3 actually is on the sphere. Actually, it's in projective space. So what is the representation? So how does a diffeomorphism act? Well, we know how it acts on a density. You have to put a Jacobian in if you want to see a function. And here it is. You don't multiply it as a function. You don't compose. You don't change variables as a function. Change variables as a measure. So it's here. And here I'm doing the obvious thing. I change variables exactly in the then. And then I multiply pointwise with the element in the group. Okay, and then so now I look at my theory, I have to compute a bunch of things. So I compute them all. What is this, what is that, what is that? There are various diamond operators because there are two groups. So you compute. The point is it's not here, it's here. Right now it's sports. Now you do exercise. Right? You don't need to think anymore, you compute. So you write the equations. So here are the equations. They are very beautiful. These are the equations. These are the real equations, so to speak. And these are the advected equations of the advected quantities. Rho and n are advected. And the real variables are u and nu. Okay? You look at these equations. Let's put in the kinetic, the energy that is given by the liquid crystal. Well, it's completely obvious. This is kinetic energy for the fluid. This is kinetic energy for the rigid body. It's not a rigid, it's a point with an arrow, but that's what I'm doing. Minus the potential energy, which physicists tell me who's have, right? It's no big philosophy. So then I compute, right? So here they are. But these are beautiful equations. They don't look like Erickson Leslie. It's true, they are Erickson Leslie. Theorem, if L0 is 1, then it stays 1 for all time. The ddt n dot nu is 0, therefore if this is 0, then it stays 0. Suppose this is 0 and suppose this is 1, as you have to in Erickson Leslie, then ddt becomes this, and this equation becomes this. Ah, it's the second the equation with two derivatives in Erickson Leslie. Conversely, so, if u nu rho n is a solution of either Poincaré equation with these initial conditions satisfying the correct ones, then u rho n is a solution of Erickson-Leslie. And conversely, if u rho n is a solution of Erickson-Leslie, defining nu to be this, then this is a solution of either Poincaré. So I can replace Erickson-Leslie by these equations. I'm going to show them to you once more because I clearly am not going to get there. In other words, you want to do analysis, well-posedness. Don't work with Erickson Leslie. It's known it's difficult. Nobody could prove it, could prove well-posedness. They take approximations. Don't do it. Do that. And let me tell you, it's not difficult. It's quite astounding. I mean, you say, well, all you did is you replaced three equations, one being second order, by four equations. First, of course I did that. But I did it in a clever way. Not just that the variable is ddt is the other one. It's this new variable, new. And this you will never guess. This you will never guess. It's geometry who tells you what to do. So geometry has not replaced analysis. It never, can never replace analysis. But it has put me on the right track. Now, proving well-posedness, okay, it's not easy, but it's standard. In other words, it's not that I had insomnia and I invented my estimate because I had indigestion the night before. No. I used standard things in books. Yes, I used Vichy operators and other things, but they're in books. So by any stretch of the imagination for a hard analyst, I'm doing standard things. And I completely agree, it's standard. So this is what I wanted to show you at the end. It's true, and the correct Sobolev spaces, this is well posed in two and three dimensions. How about Erringen? Now this I got to show you. No matter where I get to, this I have to show you. So same group. Okay? But now I have other variables. I have functions, which is really densities, measures, rho. I have moments of inertia, and I have this omega 1 d to SO3. Right? These are my variables that behave differently. Rho, j, and this gamma that depends funny. Now you apply the principle of the duck. If it walks like a duck and quacks like a duck, it is a duck. Right? Well, what is this guy? Omega 1 d in SO3. One form with values in Lie algebra. It is a connection. Right? This is what Erringen did without knowing. Now I'm going to show you the equations of Erringen. They are astounding. Now I have a representation. I do exactly as I did before, except I'm not going to write minus 1 here, because I'm in SO3, so I write transpose, right? But now, on the last guy, I have this expression. What is this expression? It's how connections change. What else can I do? The thing that absolutely, to my shame, I must confess, I never knew before I did this work that this term here has an algebraic interpretation, has to do with group cocycles. I had no idea. I had to check it by hand. I couldn't believe my eyes. I mean, what do you mean? You know, it's like, you know, I spoke prose all my life, right? I mean, it's a group cocycle. The geometers never say this. I don't know why. It has a meaning. It's not just this like this. Okay. So now I go to work. Right, I have a big cannon and I shoot with the cannon the problem, right? It's not here, it's here, it's muscle. Right? It's hard work computing. So you compute. You take the Lagrangian, which is defined on this space, right, with semi-direct product here. You write it down. What could you write down? Kinetic energy of the macro motion fluid, rigid body. There it is. 1/2 I omega m omega. There it is. Literally. Except it's written in space. Minus potential energy. And now you write the equations. Here are Erlangen's equations. The monster that you saw before, just watch it. This we understood before. This is something, okay? Look at this. If this would be zero, it's the rigid body equations. But it's not zero, because it's deforming. It has a right-hand side. Div, of course it has a div, right? And the gamma does something to it. Mass conservation. The advection of angular momentum, there it is. And now watch this equation. D dt gamma, LU gamma, if this term wouldn't be here, it would be advection. It would be exactly as you do in MHD, when you write the B equation, thought of as a two form, not as a vector. That's exactly what it is. But it's not. It's a new kind of equation. It has this. Okay, in this case, because it's SO3, so I simplified as much as I could, you know what this is. This is the covariant derivative. So the covariant derivative in this case is literally this. Take the derivative and add the bracket. Period. In this case, it's absolutely concrete. So now, look at this equation again. The variable is gamma. You take covariant derivatives relative to gamma. Gamma is time dependent. Young-Mills is playing in the sand compared to this. You see what I mean? Here you have an equation that has the connection is time dependent, and you use it in the equations to write the equations themselves. I mean, these are equations that I have never seen before. Never. Now, what did Erlangen do? Erlangen simply assumed, I tell you what he did, because he didn't know what else to do. What Erlangen did, he did this. He said, I'm going to ignore this term. I'm going to assume the initial condition is zero, I have only this term. And then I'm telling you that it's dragged by the flow in a certain way. So in some sense, he knew what he was doing. The amazing thing with Erlangen is that his computations are correct. How he did them is beyond me. I know how to compute, because I know how to compute semi-direct products, I know what the brackets are, I have structure behind me. I cannot make a mistake. I know what I'm doing. This guy did it by the seat of his pants. I have no idea how he did it. And it's correct. He has two mistakes discovered, only two. The one that I told you before, is another one, when he defines smectic, and there he deliberately confuses the Lie algebra index with the spatial index, and because there are three of them, he can't take a trace. This is not possible. This is illegal. Because I changed the group, then I'm sunk. Right? It's not possible. That's the only other mistake that I found in Erlangen. It's absolutely amazing how he did it. So, these are the equations. So now, the next step is, what do I get out of it? For example, I have Kelvin circulation theorem for U and for gamma. These are new Kelvin circulation theorem. For example, we know they're important in fluids. Well, here they are. Macro motion, micro motion. You have them. And there are all sorts of things. I mean, here I listed just a few other ones that work exactly with this theorem. That's what I'm telling you, 70 pages applying this theorem, one example after the other. Okay, now there is clearly no time to go, but so I'm going to talk 2 minutes and I'm telling you. So now, how do you show that Erlangen contains Erickson-Leslie? Here is what you do. His formula, I told you, is wrong. It it's wrong for many reasons. One of the reasons is that it doesn't have the correct invariance properties in that group. If you would be right, it should have had this. So we knew beforehand. And then we checked by hand. We wasted 2 days in case anybody asks us, here are the 16 pages, you know. It's wrong. It's almost right. Only two terms are wrong. And they have a coefficient wrong. And it's almost right. So, he was not totally wrong. This relationship is right. I mean, this is correct. This is the wrong equation. So this is geometrically consistent. And it is true, this has to be proved, this is not obvious. It is true that the psi that depends on these is a function that depends on this only. It is true. I mean, these things have to be checked. So how do we do this? It's very simple. You go to the material representation. You don't understand something, you go up. There everything is clear. Now you look at what symmetries you have. So depending on what you consider as a parameter in L, you have different groups of symmetries. But if you have a group of symmetry, well, I have a machine, I have a cannon, right? I shoot it, so I'm going to get equations, right? I take the other one, I apply the same theorem, it's another group. But they all come from the same thing, so they must be the same. Whether I like it or not. I mean, there's a change of variable in this sense. They must be equivalent in some sense. And that's exactly right. So, in order to compare Erickson-Leslie with Eringen, in fact, what we didn't compare Erickson-Leslie. The lesson is already here. Because, in fact, I didn't have Erickson-Leslie. I had these four equations. But even those are not good enough. There is something equivalent in which you have to change variables. You have to introduce the Eringen variables in Erickson-Leslie. And it can be done. You put it there, and now you compare. And then it becomes easy. So when everything is said and done, I'm just going to show you one thing. In everything is said and done, there's a whole thing. We get new equations. We compare. We go not this with this. We know that this is equivalent to some new equation, and this is what we compared with Eringen. And then they're included. And these equations are very interesting, because I think they can deal with declinations, which Erickson-Leslie cannot. That's the biggest complaint. And if you want continuum mechanics, here is the beauty. Here is the mother of all Lagrangians, and he induces everything. He induces here. He induces there, these are reductions, these are reductions, these are reductions, these are equivalent, equivalent, equivalent. Here are all the changes. New hat is always this, and they always tell you what to do, how you go from here, here, how you go from here, here. And you get equations, right? So you get all sorts of stuff here, right? Anyway, let me stop here. Thank you very much. My personal opinion is yes. I mean, look, I did the simplest possible thing. I just took rho. If I were to go from barotropic to isentropic, I have to add entropy, and then temperature comes in. So this clearly will appear. But this is not a problem in principle, because this is, it's like depending now, do you want the entropy to be a measure or do you want the entropy to be a function? That's a matter of taste, right? But of course, temperature appears in both. Right, it's only how you interpret. But this is easy in some sense because it's like a mass, right? Instead of having rho, you have rho and entropy, and instead of having here densities, you have densities and functions, and you can. You
physical ground, the phase transition.
Yeah. 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 You should. So, for example, I don't know how these declinations come. They're clearly important because this is because why we are being able to use this. These are discontinuities, right? From here to here, there is a discontinuity. That's it, there is a line here, right? And we don't know how to handle this yet. We have to put dissipation in it, we know, because these are not ideal by any chance, and they're very viscous. So you have to put this in. So when I do analysis, I have to put it, but then I put it because it's easier, right? There are all sorts of things. You have to do control theory on it, but this is controlled, right? What is the control theory for this with magnetic fields and so on? All of this is open. All of this is open. There is only one single simulation that I know of. It's in two dimensions, and it was done about 5 years ago, five, 6 years ago, by an undergraduate student at Caltech at the time, a very good guy. But in three dimensions, has it been done? It hasn't been done. This is a real challenge. And now you have to add stochastic. I mean, you know, the sky's the limit. I mean, these are 100 PhDs, right? Just take anything you want that you know in fluids and go, right? Anything. Which ones? The curvature? Oh, yes. Oh, absolutely. If you want me to give you a formulation of Erringen in terms of curvature, I can do it. Oh, absolutely. I can think of the curvature as a variable. There's another formulation with having to do with curvature. There's Hamiltonian formulation. We have done it all.
Because there clearly the leadership
term to be from office term. Oh, yes. Absolutely. 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 So this is, right, I mean, this is his other mistake. He said this is true. But you cannot. The indices are space and the algebra. You cannot take a trace of green indices with blue indices. It's not possible. Right? Yes, yes. Yeah, we can handle Young-Mills fluids. Absolutely. This is part of the job, part of the game. This is one of the examples we can do. Yes, we can do superfluids. We can do HBVK approximations. We can do, there are many, many. I just chose this one because it's the most spectacular one.
There is no other things that we add a comment. And ask a question. As maybe you know that I worked a lot in higher gradient.
A higher grade.
That we started with Antonelli Grablo some years ago, and we submitted recently a paper not yet published, in which we added extra gradients for density and normal. Do you see any difficulty in
no.
analyzing this?
No, I didn't need it. But if you want to have higher variation calculus with higher derivatives, I have a paper I can show you. It has to do with Ostrogradsky's work and so on. So you can do it.
The question is that your lines of discontinuity are regularized.
Yes.
And this could be a way.
Yes. Yes, so absolutely I could in principle add more derivatives here, and I know how to do it in principle. Yeah, I can show you this, yes.
Okay, so if there is no other question, maybe we can switch to the next.
Thank you.